really pretty. Every time I do a day, shouldn't say we may start to see them. See. Every time I do a deed I shouldn't do, every time I say a word I shouldn't say, let me tell you what I do, and it brings a blessing too. I just steal away somewhere and pray. I just steal away, I just steal. My head in shame, and some idle wanderer lead along my way. But I never am ashamed of my Savior's precious name. I just steal away somewhere and pray. I just steal away, I just steal away. Christ the Savior always hears an answered prayer, and He gives me many blessings every day. So when I have tried my best and I fail to pass the test, I just steal away somewhere and pray. I just steal away, I just steal away. And I ask the blessing to lead the way. I just steal away, I just steal away, I just steal away somewhere and pray.
Over in the great beyond, where the Savior there shall be glory shared, where the silver in heaven will ring forevermore. Everybody will be happy over there. Everybody will be. Sister and brother will be singing around the clock, and nothing where no one ever goes again. And the Christians of all ages will join in the quiet talk. Everybody will be happy over there. Everybody will be happy.
Amen. Amen. Our dear Heavenly Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. We come to you on top of this hill to worship and to praise you. And Lord, we just ask that you fill us with your Spirit today. Give us an understanding of your word. Give us the courage and the wisdom to apply that, to expand your kingdom, bring honor and glory to your name. In Jesus' precious name, we pray these things. Amen. Amen. All right. Well, we want to welcome you if you are joining us by Facebook this year of our Lord, December 10th, 2023. And if you know what the year of our Lord means. If you pick up a bulletin in our newsletter that's available at each one of the entrances. But this week, we have some wonderful birthdays. On the 11th, we have Kim Riddle. Also, Nikki McCarley. On the 12th, Dana Wallum. Diana Wallum. I missed the I there. Okay, and on the 14th, Kathy Steele. And on the 15th, Dave Ellenberg. And also, Belinda Palasak in the Philippines. All right. And anniversaries. No anniversaries this week. Did we miss any birthdays or anniversaries that we can? On the 11th. Who? Trey Perry on the 11th. And Michael Garza on the. Riker. Riker, yes. Riker Garza on the 11th. Yes. All right. So put those on there. All right. Any anniversaries? Okay. Well, let's do happy birthdays.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you and me more.
Amen. All right, we do not take up an organized offering here at Cowboy Church. We do have a leather can at each one of the entrances. However, the Lord leads your heart in that matter, they are there for your convenience. And we do have spiral notebooks that should be making the rounds. If you have a prayer request or a praise report that you would like the men to pray over after the service, you can write that on the notebooks, and they will take care of that after our service today. All right, this week we have on Saturday at 7 p.m. here at the church, the men's gathering. So if you would like men, if you'd like to come, just gather, sing, do whatever activities men do on a Saturday evening that's designed by the Lord. That's what we do. All right, and then next Sunday will be our Christmas fellowship lunch, so I invite you to be a part of that. And so we will do that on the 3rd, bring a nice dessert or side entree, and we will look forward to fellowshipping together next Sunday, the 17th. All right, what else do we have? I think that's all of messages, announcements. All right, so we're going to have our congregationals and then band Sunday today. So we look forward to that. And so let's praise our Savior in song, and we'll go from there. It's all yours, Don.
Okay. It is no secret what God can do. The chime of time ring out the news, another day is through. Someone stepped out. Was that someone you may have? For that is great, your courage to be. Do not be disheartened, for I bring hope to you. It is no secret what God can do. Arms wide open, he'll pardon you. It is no secret what God can do. There is no night, for in his light
You'll never walk alone. Always feel at home. Wherever you may roam, there is no power can conquer you. Pardon you. It is no secret what God
Good morning.
Wow. All right.
Well,
He didn't bring his fiddle, though.
Oh, man, I tell you what. Christmas is almost here, y'all. It's really close. And I was talking to Kelly the other day. You know, the last few years, I've got into the bad habit of thinking about everything I've lost. And kind of got me down when Christmas time got here, and I wasn't very into the spirit. So we was talking the other day and everything, and I said, you need to start kicking me in the rear and making me get out of that. And she's been real good about doing it so far, so I'm kicking me in the rear better, not making me better. But anyhow, we need to really think about what we're celebrating. You know, Christmas is about Christ. Of course, we all know that. They like to commercialize all this stuff and everything, make it about the toys and the stuff that you can buy and good times and all that and everything. And what I see out in the public out there and the general stuff that they're putting out, they're not saying hardly anything about what the season is actually about. So I just wanted to put my 2 cents worth in and say Jesus is the reason for this season. And that I love seeing him and his name, especially at the first of this thing, because if it wasn't for Christ, we wouldn't have Christmas. So I'll stop my speech now. I'm going to turn it over and let Robert do his first number.
Good morning. Y'all have to excuse me this morning. I'm playing a new guitar here that the old man back here fixed for me. Y'all have heard this song before. I've sung it with my son, and unfortunately, he's not here today. He wasn't feeling the greatest, so I'm going to have to do it without him, but that's what I had prepared. Yo, this song, Peter, Do You Love Me? Jesus made all those sacrifices for us. For how long? I think the Bible says he lived for 33 years and made sacrifices or was teaching every day. What kind of sacrifices are we making for him?
Peter, do you love me? Go and feed my sheep. Peter, do you love me? Take care of the weak. Peter, do you love me? Stand up and be strong. Now I have to go away, but I'll not leave you alone. They took the Lord from the garden. Peter followed them. Someone recognized him, said, "There's one of them." Peter, he denied them 3 times in a row. And his heart was broken when he heard the old cock crow. Peter, do you love me? Go and feed my sheep. Peter, do you love me? Take care of the weak. Peter, do you love me? Stand up and be strong. Think you have to go away, but I'll not leave you alone. But on the day of Pentecost, the Comforter arrived. Came in like a rushing wind, glowing tongues of fire. Peter stood up and began to preach to them the holy word. And after 3,000 souls were saved, these words you might have heard. Peter, do you love me? Go and feed my sheep. Peter, do you love me? Take care of the weak. Peter, do you love me? Stand up and be strong. Now I have to go away, but I'll not leave you alone. Peter grew stronger in the faith, preached throughout the land. He walked and he talked and he prayed to God, obeying his command. When they crucified him, they nailed him upside down. And these words you might have heard as the hammer rang out loud. Lord, you know I love you. Lord, you know I love you. I've took care of the weak. Lord, you know I love you. I've tried to be so strong. Thank you, Lord, for loving me. Now I'm ready to go home.
These people gave me a hard time all my life about how tall I am. I don't doubt that. Mounds, you'll come up here and play bass for me? You sure? How about a guitar? We can find you a guitar. Oh, there might be.
Yeah.
There's another bass up here. We can double up.
There's 6-string right there, Stevie.
Okay. Now you got me messed up.
We got you messed up?
Yeah. Gee. I guess. I forgot what I was going to do. All right, we're going to do one of Mama's songs. Just because. I can't remember what I was going to do. Well, I am weak and now I'm strong. Jesus, keep me from all wrong. I'll be satisfied as long as I walk. Just my burden share. None but Thee, dear Lord, none but Thee. Just a closer walk with Thee. Granny, Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to Thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be. Play it again, Sam.
I want to tell y'all a story, but I don't want to be in trouble.
Go ahead.
Clay was walking up here.
Trouble.
Yeah, I know. Clay was walking up here, and y'all was talking. We got a little comments over here about using the orange mic. And when I first met Clay after marrying Kelly there and everything, he invited me to come down to the fire department because I was qualified to join, and he wanted to know if everybody be in agreement with it. So we all get down there. They voted me in. They got me on the department. In the first meeting, I didn't say anything. I just kind of sat around there, and everybody didn't know anything about me. And they're giving him a hard time all the time where they're kept calling him midget and this, that, and the other. And I kept looking over. I was going, why are they picking on poor old Clay like that all the time? Of course, I didn't know at the time that Clay kind of brings this on. So anyhow, we're sitting there. And these guys are giving him a hard time about being short and calling him midget and all that and everything. We came to that next meeting next month, and they was in there, and somebody came in, and they popped off and said something about, hey, midget. And I just jumped up, and I looked at everybody out there, and I said, hey. They all stopped and looked, and I said, that's enough about that. I said, that's my brother-in-law you're talking about. Well, I said, no, really. I said, everybody knows he's not a midget. And they kind of looked around a little bit and everything. I said, he's got to be a leprechaun. He's not no midget. Now, that was a little bit of humor on my part. Was it 3 years ago you came over to the house? Very seldom you ever find me, I'm not wearing my cowboy boots. But he came over to the house that day, and he came in there, and he was upset about something. And we were standing, come here. So y'all can get an idea. We were standing like this. And I didn't have my cowboy boots on. And he kept looking, and all of a sudden he just stopped in the middle of this thing and looked at me, and he goes, "You're as short as I am." I said, "You just now figuring that out."
I was looking down at him.
Yes. Yes, he was. It was a funny deal, though, because he had the strangest look on his face.
Have you seen the high-heeled boots that he wears?
Anyhow, a little humorous there for you. But I'll tell you this much. That may be a small package right there that you're looking at, but you can't find anybody that's got a bigger heart or does any more for anybody that's in need. And I will brag on my brother-in-law because I love him so much, and I've seen what he does. And he's just a blessing in my life, even if he is short. So don't get short with me now.
A short blessing.
That's right. All right. Well, I told you it's almost Christmas time, so I'm going to do a little Christmas tune here. If y'all know the words, sing along with me. I think everybody knows this one. And while we're at it, let's just all stand, and we'll get the blood flowing in your feet again. G. Silent Night.
Well, silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright, round yonder mother and child, holy infant so tender and mild, sleep in heavenly peace,
Christmas, everybody. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this day that you have given to us, for this place that's up on top of this hill that we can come and worship your name, Father. We are so so glad that you gave your son for us, Father. And we want to tell you how much we appreciate you doing that for us. And we want to let you know that we are celebrating his birthday. It is Christmas, Father. We thank you for all the blessings you've given to us. We thank you for watching over us. We thank you for your healing. We just ask that you drench this place in your spirit now, and that we will be ready to hear the words that you have for us to hear today. And we just ask that you bless everyone that's here, Father. Open our hearts. Get us in the right mood for the birth of your son. And keep us there, Father. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. And we thank you mainly for your son, Jesus. It's in his name that we pray. Amen.
Amen. Stay standing. While you're standing, for about 2 or 3 minutes, go visit with somebody. Find out who they are. What do you say, young lady? Good, doing good, doing good. Oh, oh, oh. Ask everybody if they would ease back to their places. Good to see you, young man. Good to see you. Well, good to see you, young lady. Ask everybody to ease back to your places. Love you, bugger. Appreciate you. I'm going to ask you this morning if you would turn to Matthew 10, Mark 1, Mark 16, Luke 10, Ephesians 6, and Acts 10. And while you're doing that, I want to welcome our Facebook viewers. We always appreciate you tuning in and being part of our services. And once again, enjoy the feedback we get. It means a lot to us, and we really appreciate it. While you're doing that, we're fixing to draw for last month's youth winners in the youth class. Janie.
Chucky.
Mary Dale. Amen. Amen. Yarnmaker, split that with you, Janie. Amen. Amen. Yeah, Chuck. No. Did you enjoy the band this morning? Amen. Did a good job. Appreciate it. Beginning with Matthew 10, and this is Jesus. And when he had called unto him his 12 disciples, he gave them power against unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of diseases. Matthew 8, heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out devils, freely you receive, freely given. He's telling the disciples what to do here. Mark 1:23, and there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, saying, let us alone. What have we to do with you, Jesus of Nazareth? Are you come to destroy us? I know you, who you are, the Holy One of God. And Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Hold your peace and come out of him." And when the unclean spirit had torn him and cried with a loud voice, he came out of him. Verse 39, and he preached in their synagogues throughout all Galilee, cast out devils. Mark 16:17, and these signs shall follow them that believe. Say that with me, believe. In my name shall they cast out devils, they shall speak with new tongues. And the 70, say that with me, 70. If nothing else out of this verse, you always hear, well, that was only for the 12, the disciples or apostles. But here there were 70, doesn't even tell you who they were whatsoever, those followers of Jesus, returned again with joy, saying, "Lord, even the devils are subject unto us through your name." Ephesians 6:10, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood. This scripture right here, everybody ought to have it written down and remember it. It tells you where most of your problems are. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Therefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in evil day, and having done all, to stand. Acts 10:38, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. I'm going to ask Thomas Hobson if he would to bless the word this morning. Amen, amen. Today's message is for each and every one of you. You know, if you do a message on salvation, people already been saved again, then that message is not necessarily for them. But today's message is for each and every one of you, either for yourself or for your loved ones. And what we're going to deal with for just a few moments today are demons, devils, evil spirits, and rulers of darkness. Now, there are basically two opinions on the subject of demons. You have, number one, people think, well, there's a demon behind every bush, you know. I mean, if they have a 10-year-old battery on their car goes out, they want to cast the demon out of it. The second opinion is that they no longer exist. That all of a sudden, when Jesus died, all the demons ceased to exist. Or either that, or there's a big high fence, which we know our border's not fenced, but somehow they can't get across the Rio Grande. If you read the Word, you'll find this out. Jesus spent most of his ministry doing two things: healing people and casting out demons. And yet we see so very little of that being taught in our churches today. You know, if you read the book of Acts, the early church, you'll see where they cast demons out of people. The Word tells us this, that in the latter days, and I certainly believe we're in the latter of the latter days, that demon activity would begin to increase. And we see that today through what all's going on, the woke agenda. I mean, it's absolutely, you know, Dave Ellenberg gave me some literature the other day on the woke, kind of how things have got started on transgenders and all that. And that's nothing but demonic activity. You call it whatever you want to. In 1 Timothy 4:1, it says that in the latter days, people would give heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. Well, I mean, that's exactly what's going on in the United States today. People are listening to doctrines of devils. And we're absolutely seeing this fulfillment of this verse in our day and time. Not only that, we are guilty, saints, of setting our own children up to be influenced and possessed by demons. Harry Potter portrays to be this cute, innocent boy, and these kids, you know, they're just having fun. But what you don't understand, it appears innocent, but yet you see them, and the kids see them practicing the basic principles of the occult. Blood sacrifices, hexes, curses, instruction from witches. I'm going to tell you this. When you play with the occult, it invites the prince of darkness to take you. And what saddens me is I've seen churches under the disguise, well, it gets them to read or so forth. Well, why not give them Playboy or something, you know? But they want to use that for an excuse for letting kids read these books. I'm telling you this, if you have those books in your house, don't give them to somebody. Burn them. Yeah. Throw them away. Because that, in the Old Testament, God put witches and warlocks to death. Now, he has not changed his view or his opinion on those subjects today. And so you need to get that in your mind and in your thoughts. There's nothing about the occult, witches or warlocks, that God finds innocent, he finds funny, or he thinks is okay. Now, husbands, this is one of those times you need to look right straight at me. Don't be looking around. How many of you today believe you could tell if someone was demon-possessed? You know, one day there's a preacher, he got up during the service, and I mean he was giving the devil what for. People were clapping and applauding. All of a sudden, the devil appears on stage. Then people went up, stampeded like a bunch of cows, jumped through the windows and everything else, except for one old man on the front row. And the devil looked down, he said, "Aren't you afraid of me?" He said, "No, sir, I've been living with your sister for 40 years. Amen. People say, "Well, I know." See, we got this idea that if someone's demon-possessed, we'd know because they go around sputtering and carrying on so forth and all that. Stop and think just a moment. How many times do you hear about a serial killer and they interview their neighbors and friends and they didn't have a clue? Well, who do you think influenced them? Who do you think possesses them? Ted Bundy, you know, they just talk about what a nice guy he was, but yes, he was one of the most prolific, can't even say it, best cell killers that ever lived, you know. So that tells you, should give you a clue. You cannot tell when people are demon-possessed necessarily. You know, in Mark 1, verse 23-26, we just read, do you understand this man that Jesus cast a demon out was in a church service? Demons, I'll tell you what right now, there's some people in this church service that are demon-possessed. Oh, brother, no, that's what the book says right here. You just don't know it, don't understand. I've been, my eyes opened over the years to that. But that should give you a clue that if that man was comfortable in a church service, how you're dealing daily with demon-possessed people, demon-influenced people, and there's a difference, and we'll get into that in just a moment, and you're unaware of it. Now, there is a difference between possession and influence. We just read about the influences in Ephesians 6, verses 10 through 13. Now, there may be areas in your life that's being influenced by the demons or by the spirits of darkness, and you may, for a period of time, be able to overcome them just by the will of the flesh. Then all of a sudden, when you think you got it whipped, they jump up and you do just exactly what you've been saying you wouldn't ever do again. What about anger? Maybe you've had a problem with anger, but you think, well, I've got it under control now and then. And then all of a sudden, something just sets you off. Well, let me tell you what, that's not a spirit from God when that happened. That's a spirit of evilness, of wickedness. What about lust? You know, well, I've got this under control and everything, never going to do this again. Then all of a sudden, it jumps up and gets you. Well, you were influenced. Depression. Do you know, they tell me the number one problem within the church is depression. And if there was ever a group of people that shouldn't have depression, it's God's people. But it's an evil, wicked spirit. It's a spirit of darkness. And it can get a hold of you and you know what it is, what's going on, and not being able to overcome it. Maybe fear, you know, a spirit of fear. There's some fear that's normal. You should have. I mean, if you're not afraid to pick up a rattlesnake, you're stupid, you know. But if you think you're afraid to go outside because you're liable to step on one, that's the other. That's the spirit of fear. That's from Satan. Gossip. When you gossip, who do you think that spirit comes from? Do you think that's God's influencing you to go spread tales about your brothers and sisters and what's going on? No, you're being influenced by spirits of darkness. Worry. We can certainly all, most of us, fall into that category. Who do you think, if the Bible tells you not to do something and you do it, then that tells you who's behind what you're doing. That's Satan. And worry is a major problem. Suicide is a spirit of darkness that gets into people's mind and tells them that's the only way out. So they're being influenced by a spirit of darkness. Peter, when he rebuked the Lord, remember that story in the Bible, Jesus tells him, says, "Get behind me, Satan." Now, he was not possessed, but Jesus realized he was being influenced by Satan. The demon-possessed man in Mark 5 could not be controlled by any human means. You know, I love this. Jesus cast him out. The people were scared of him. He was running through the cemeteries, the countryside and everything. Jesus cast him out, sets him free. You would have thought those people would have begged Jesus to stay with them. They didn't. They got to tell him they need him to leave, you know, get out of the way. Demon-possessed girl, Paul cast a demon out of her. And I always thought this kind of funny because she would go around town and said, these men, listen to you, these men are from God. And you'd think, well, she was doing that. God does not use demons to spread the gospel or to spread his word. And Paul had a discerning spirit, a gift of the spirits, and he realized who was behind her. Influenced and possessed, people that are influenced and possessed, you're delivered by the same means. We found that in Mark 16, verse 17. You're delivered through the name of Jesus. When a believer that believes in that takes authority over those spirits of darkness in the name of Jesus, they have to go. You don't pray demons out. You don't reason or threaten demons out. You don't counsel demons out. You cast them out in the authority of the name and the blood of Jesus Christ. And when you stand your ground, they have to leave. Now, we know that it's through the authority of the believer. But how much do you hear being taught about the authority of the believer in today's churches? Just begin listening on TV sometimes. You don't hear those messages, but they think you're radical, you're a nut if you get up there and go talking about that. And then we wonder why our country's getting in the shape it is. You know, we're wondering why 3 out of 4 kids that's raised up in the church fall away from their salvation when they leave and go out away from home. Because we're not being taught spiritual warfare and the authority of the believer in people's lives. Now, people say, well, what inspired today's message? A man came to me one day. He said, how do I answer my wife when she says there cannot be a loving God because I was abused as a child? And if God loves you, he wouldn't allow that done. So therefore, I can't believe in God. And when he asked me that, it reminded me of an experience I'd had with a demon-possessed man in the years past. And just how cunning Satan is when it comes to demon possessions and the spirits of darkness. Now, I've shared this several years ago, but I feel like sharing again with you today. It's not that I'm getting old and forgetful. I just think it's most of you were probably asleep or weren't here or weren't paying attention or whatever. But one night I was sitting at home, and a man called me out of the dark, out of the blue. I mean, he didn't come to church here, didn't know the man or anything, but he just called me. And he said, if I knew where a boy could be sent for help, a troubled kid. And I said, well, yeah, I know some places, maybe, you know. And then he asked me, and I hadn't said anything about it, if I believed someone could be demon-possessed. And I answered him, I said, well, the Word teaches they can be. And I thought when he asked me that, he was talking about that boy. But after a few minutes, I realized he was talking about himself. And he went on to tell me that he had been diagnosed clinically with 13 different personalities. Well, he kind of got my attention, you know. And those 13 personalities, you've got to understand, are demon spirits, they're fallen angels, and they're evil spirits. Well, when he got to tell me that, I invited him to church. I said, why don't you come to church and we'll begin to deal with those demonic spirits. He said, I can't go in a church because when I do, I get extreme headaches. Now, I want him here at church for this reason. The Bible says that where two or more gathered in the name of Jesus, Jesus is in our midst. And then I also knew the presence of the Holy Spirit would be there. Years ago, we were attending a convention, a Copeland convention down at Fort Worth. And I never will forget about this day. I was learning some things. There's a woman started up the stairs to go down in the convention, and she just fell over and went to screaming and hollering and just, you know, it got my attention once again. And what it was demonic spirits in her. She couldn't stand to go down in where the Holy Spirit and all that was operating in the floor. Well, I told him, I said, well, since you can't come to church, I'll get one of the other brothers to come and we'll get with you together. And he said, no, he said, I don't really want anyone else to know what I'm dealing with, so I just want to meet with you alone. Well, once again, he had my attention, and I agreed to meet him. Because I was interested, I wanted to find out more. Well, I met him on Friday morning in my office. Now, and I've changed these names to protect, some of you here know the person, but I've changed the names to protect this man, so I'm going to call him Bob. And when we got in my office, we was in this office over here where the deacon's at now. It was real small. And I started, first of all, asking him about demons and the doctor's diagnosis of his 13 different personalities. And then all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit checked me, and he said, ask him if he's saved. I said, have you been saved? He said, well, I've been baptized. Well, let me tell you what, they stake you out all night in deep water and not make you saved. Baptized does not save you. And when he answered that, when somebody tells me that, I know they haven't been born again. And I knew that he wasn't saved. And then all of a sudden, when I said that, one of the other personalities, one of the 13, we'll call him Bill, he came out. And he began to share with me that as a child, Bob had been horribly abused by godly foster parents. I mean, it was horrible abuse, physically and mentally. And what had happened, when that happened, the demons got hold of him mentally and allowed him the only way to survive that. They were his protector, and they were his deliverer. Bill, the demon, then asked me, wanted to know if he and the others could be saved, the other demons. And my answer was this, no. Your evil spirit, your demons. And Bill said, well, why not? We saved Bob's life. See, it was the ultimate lie. The demons and spirits of darkness was behind the abuse, but now they were going to claim his salvation. That's the way Satan operates. He's very sharp, very clever. And they had lied, deceived this man. Now, the man who had earlier asked how a loving God could allow his wife to abuse as a child, Satan was behind that. He was behind what happened to her, but she was blaming it on God. God gets blamed for a lot of stuff he had nothing to do with, and a lot of the pulpits on Sunday morning are guilty of that, blaming God for things that's going on in people's life God had nothing to do with. Now, when I told Bill that they couldn't be saved, I mean, he flew into a rage. We're in this little bitty office up here. I've got a desk. And, you know, I put it just as gently and delicately as I can. All hell broke loose. I'm behind the desk over here in the corner. He began hollering, ranting, cursing, and spit was just flying everywhere, you know. I really thought he got up in my face. He was fixing to hit me. And then I looked into his eyes, in the mirror of his soul, and it was the darkest thing I'd ever seen. It was like you looking straight into the pits of hell. Now, I refused to deal with Bill, that demon, from that point on. I didn't address him. Jesus told the demons to come out. He didn't argue with them. He didn't debate them. He didn't command them. I mean, but he commanded them to come out. Now, as Bill, the demon, ran in and raved, I just began to quote scriptures to him, Mark 16:17, Matthew 10:1. Then I begin to take my Bible, and he's ranting and raving, cursing, spitting and everything else, right up on top of the desk. But I always addressed him as Bob. I'd say, Bob, the Word says this. Bob, the Word says that. Then I'd read the Word to him. Finally, after a period of time, he left. And when I walked outside of the church, my sister Teresa and a friend of hers were waiting in the car outside. I didn't know they were coming. I hadn't heard from her. Now, they had walked into the building when he was screaming, hollering, and cussing. They just eased right back out the door, got back in their car. Now, the reason Teresa and this lady, a friend of hers, happened to be there, and she said we had prayed that when we went to Wichita that you'd be there, that this lady was going to Wichita to see her 12-year-old boy, who she believed was demon-possessed. He was in the hospital up there. And she wanted to know that when he got out, would I cast the demon out? I said, sure. I mean, hey, I done dealt with Bob and Bill. Nothing bothered me this time. And I was a firm believer, Mark 16:17, in my name they shall cast out devils. Well, she brought the boy by. I got the chance, and I cast that demon out, and that boy was healed and well from that moment on. Never more influence. I got home. The phone rang, and it was Bob. He said, well, I hope you wasn't scared. And I said, no, I wasn't. Then Bill came on. But once again, I refused to address Bill. I told Bob, I said, Bob, God loves you. And Bill answered, well, we'll tell him that. And I said, no, you don't say anything. You're not going to bring salvation. Bob, God loves you. Bob, you're listening, and I want you to understand they have no part whatsoever in your salvation. Then another spirit came out and began to tell me how much they liked me, what a good person I was, you know. And I refused to deal with that spirit either. I continued to talk to Bob, that God loved him, wanted him free, and so forth. And that's how I dealt with it. Now, there were two things that Bill, the demon, said in my office that really struck home with me. They made the statement, you mean to tell me that people in insane asylum are demon-possessed? I never said a word about this. I'd often believed it. If they're not in their right mind, that tells me there's demonic influence, evil spirit there. The lady that brought her son by here, there's that spirit behind him. The second thing that really struck home to me was the sound of his voice and the look in his eyes when he said that he had no chance to escape hell. If you ever deal with a demon-possessed person, you look in their eyes and you see the despair and the agony in there. Because he knew there was a hell and what it was like. It wasn't a theory to him. It wasn't something in the Bible. That demon knew what hell was like. James 2:19 says, you believe there's one God, you do well. The demons also believe and tremble. The demons know. In Matthew 25:41, then shall he also say unto them on the left hand, depart from me, you cursed, into everlasting fire prepared for the devil and for his angels. They know what their destiny is. And they want to take as many of you with them as they can. They want to torture you before you get there. They want to make you suffer beyond measure because they know what they're fixing to happen. If you don't believe there's a hell, I wish you could have heard his voice and looked into his eyes when I told him that they couldn't be saved. Now, let me ask you this. How many problems are you and your loved ones dealing with that are demon-inspired? I'm not saying possessed, but we just named over a bunch of things that's going on in your life. Those are influences. Demons, we know this in the Word, can cause deafness, can cause you to be mute. It can cause sicknesses and so forth. You know, a woman was bent over with the spirit of infirmity. They can cause behavioral problems, demonic influence, and so forth. The word says this, the god of this world, which is Satan. We understand sometimes why people can't change or understand about salvation and so forth. And the Bible very plainly about it tells us in 2 Corinthians. Because the god of this world, which is Satan, you got to understand, when Adam fell, he turned authority of the earth over to Satan. And people got this idea of God's running around, got everything under control and doing everything. No, Satan has the legal authority in this world. How many are allowing Satan free reign to enter your children through books, cartoons? You better be very close and look at the cartoons you watch on Saturday morning. So many of them are demonic inspired, it would rattle you to your feet. The books that they're reading, the things, the movies. I mean, it is absolutely nearly impossible to go to a movie that's not R-rated. You know, look at Disney. I mean, he's got to be turned over in his grave. They're one of the most woke companies that's happening. Yet people will shell out big bucks to go Disneyland, Disney World, you know, and be put up with all that stuff. How many are headed to hell because they're blaming God for Satan's work? Some of you here today, maybe you're thinking, just like this man, well, God can't be a loving God or this wouldn't happen to me or to my family. How many of you are even aware of demons? Some of you today are saying, well, that's fanatical. I always thought it was real ironic because I would walk down in a cafe during the week and this man sitting right there among his friends, they were laughing, carrying on, drinking coffee. They did not have a clue what was going on in his life. He was a very likable guy, smile on his face and so forth. But how many things are going on around you and around people that you don't understand that they're dealing with demons in their life? How many of you even know how to use the authority you have in the name of Jesus to cast Satan out of you and your loved ones? We just read about the 70. This isn't just a 12 disciple deal. Every born again believer, it tells us in Mark 16 or 17, has authority in the name of Jesus to cast them out. A lot of things, you're trying to reason things out of your children, your loved ones. You're trying to talk things out of your children, your loved ones. And there's a spirit of darkness that's behind them. That's what makes meth so bad. Because they tell me there's a lot of spiritual things goes on in the making of meth. And that's why you can just get hooked. They tell me doing it one time. Because there's a spiritual warfare. As demon activity increases, especially in the last days, you need to be aware of what's going on. Now, men, have a little common sense. When your wife jumps on you, don't begin casting out Satan in the name of Jesus. You know, I'll have to be praying for your healing, you know. Have a little common sense, but you know of things in your life. If you're dealing with depression, that's what's influencing the spirit of darkness. And you need to get you or somebody to take authority over it. I've been delivered from it. I know how what goes on. I've been dealt with it and so forth. But when I had some people took authority over it and knew what they were doing, I never dealt with it after that. So you know, it's a spirit of darkness that's operating in your life. How many of you have opened the door for evil spirits to enter your life through either maybe drugs, through the occult, the witchcraft? How many of you played with the Ouija board when you was young? And you say, well, Brother Larry, that's harmless. That's just right up Satan's alley. It just opens the door for something else to allow Satan to come in. How about the movies, the books? Those people that sit around watching them old horror movies, you're doing nothing. Years ago, I watched the Texas Chainsaw Massacre. Any of y'all? I couldn't go to sleep for 2 days. I had to sleep with the lights on, you know. Why sit and watch that trash? If you go to sleep at night after watching John Hagee or somebody like that, you'll get a good night's rest, and you won't have to put up that other junk. But you watch them old teardrop movies, you know. Someone passes away, and the first time the doctor comes to you and gives you a bad report, you immediately think you're going to die. You know. Quit doing that stuff. Fill your mind with the Word of God and the things of God, and you take a stand against Satan and all his devices and all his schemes. Saints, it's time that we quit playing church, we quit playing Christianity, and we begin to take the tools that God's given us and begin to set people free, set ourselves free, and begin to take authority over Satan and his devices. If Jesus dealt with it, like I say, next to healing, the number two ministry, maybe right up there with it in his walk on earth, and it has not changed. I'm going to ask you to stand right now. Head bowed and eyes closed. No one looking. But you've got something in your life that you don't like and you don't want it. And you've tried to get rid of it. And it just keeps popping up. And this morning you won't set free. Just slip your hand up. Amen, 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 amen. Father God, these are your children. They're blood bought. Jesus bought and paid for their healing, for their deliverance. And in the name of Jesus, I bind the spirits of darkness off their lives. I command them to leave their presence. I command them to leave their influences. And from this moment on, by faith, they're going to claim deliverance and free from your authority and your influences. Every head bowed and eye closed. Some of you here today are dealing with depression. And people, it's a big deal. And there's nothing to be ashamed of. Maybe when I dealt with it, I didn't even tell my wife. Things were going wonderful in my life. So that has nothing to do with it. But you're dealing with depression and you won't set free today. Slip your hand up. Amen, amen, amen. See those hands. Depression, you spirit straight from the pits of hell. I bind you off each one of these individuals in the name of Jesus Christ. I plead the blood of Jesus over them. And in Jesus' name, they are free from this moment on. All spirits of depression have to be gone. And they are set free, and they're set free in the name of Jesus. And all the people said, amen. Head still bowed, and eye closed. There's someone here on Facebook, and you listen to today's message, and you think it's a bunch of bull. But right now, the Holy Spirit is going to begin to open your eyes, and you're going to see how much of your life and how much of your loved ones have been influenced by spirits of darkness. And in the name of Jesus, you're going to begin to take authority over them, and you're going to be set free. There's someone on Facebook or here today, and you have a pain right in the middle of your chest. I mean, it hurt. You may have had a heart attack or are fixing to have one. But it just feels like something's sitting on it. But right now, in the name of Jesus, by the authority of his shed blood, you're healed. That pain's leaving in Jesus' name. Amen, amen. Saints, take what I said today. Fear, anger, gossip, lust, any of that are spirits of darkness that's operating in your life. Take authority over them and quit letting them rule you and your loved ones. Set free. The word says those that Jesus set free are free indeed. And you have every right to live a happy, peaceful, free life. And you quit letting Satan rob and steal from you, destroying you and your family. Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap this morning. I'm going to ask Thomas Hobson and Keith, would y'all come up? They're going to be up here to anoint you and pray with you, put oil on you and pray for you today. A prayer cloth or whatever you need. Saints, please, don't just hear something on Sunday and forget it. Go home and study it. Read the scriptures and so forth. And It's just amazing how much we deal with and we allow Satan to deal in our lives that we don't have to put up with. And ours and our children's. So begin to take authority over them. We love you and we appreciate you. Like I say, these men will be up here to pray for you at the end of the service. And anoint cloth and so forth. I'm going to ask. Yes, ma'am. Okay. Sure.
Jesus, if you bless Israel, I'll bless you. So I'd like for our church every day that we'll bind and pray for those people to be set free. I thought of Peter in prison, and the Christian prayed, and the Lord opened the doors.
Amen.
You could set those people free.
I believe, sir. Amen, amen. I believe every Christian's duty should be every day praying for Israel, protection on their troops, the hostages, and so forth. It saddens me to see our country stand on a lot of this stuff, you know. And we're all get by with it. I mean, people think everything revolves around America. I think God established America strictly for Israel. And when we fail to take, when we go to putting pressure on them to cease fire and do stuff like that, we're going to pay a price for it, but I agree with you 100%. I'm going to ask Dave Ellenberg, give me a little head start, pray for Israel, and then pray blessings upon the church. Love you. Y'all have a wonderful week.